Good morning.
Flippin' physics.
Let's determine the electric field at point P, which is located a distance A to the left of a thin rod with a charge positive capital Q. Uniform charge density lowercase lambda and length capital L. Notice that if we were to place a small positive test charge at point P, it would experience a force to the left from every dq or every infinitesimally small part of the wire. Therefore, we already know the direction of the electric field at point P. It will be to the left or in the negative I direction. However, if point P were not located on the axis of the thin rod, every dq would cause an electric field in a slightly different direction, which would, as I said before, make this mathematically a much more difficult problem, and you are not responsible for finding the electric field relative to continuous charge distributions, which are not highly symmetrical. Billy, please solve for the electric field.
Absolutely. Previously, we determined the electric field from a continuous charge distribution equals the Coulomb constant times the integral of dq over r squared times unit vector r. In this case, rather than unit vector r, let's replace that with the negative of unit vector I, because we already determined that a small positive test charge would experience an electrostatic force to the left at point P. Also, rather than r squared in the denominator, let's put x squared in the denominator because dq is located to the right of point P at a variable distance in the x direction, or x. We cannot really take the integral of the linear variable x with respect to charge, so we need to use linear charge density to go from dq to dx in the integral. We know linear charge density equals the total charge on the rod, capital Q, divided by the total length of the rod, capital L. Linear charge density also equals the infinitesimally small charge dq divided by the width of dq, which is in the x direction. So let's call that dx. That means dq equals linear charge density times dx, and the total charge equals linear charge density times the total length. We can substitute linear charge density times dx in for dq and take negative unit vector I out from the integral. Actually, linear charge density is also constant over the whole length of the rod, so that can come out from the integral as well. The limits on x for the rod are, the distance x for the location of dq varies from the left end of the rod to the right end of the rod, so the integral goes from distance A to distance A plus capital L. The inverse of x squared is the same as x to the negative 2 power. The integral of x to the negative 2 power with respect to x equals x to the negative 1 power divided by negative 1. The negatives cancel one another out, and x to the negative 1 power is the same as the inverse of x. We can substitute in our limits, solve for a common denominator in the brackets. In the numerator, we have a minus capital L. That means the electric field at point P equals negative Coulomb constant times linear charge density times the length of the rod, all divided by the quantity A times the quantity A plus capital L, all times unit vector I. Actually, we could do one more simplification. Previously, I showed that the total charge on the rod, capital Q, equals linear charge density times the length of the rod, so we can substitute the total charge on the rod into the electric field equation. I think that's it.
Well done, Billy. I do want to make sure everyone recognizes what happens if the distance to point P from the left end of the rod, or A in this example, is much, much larger than the length of the rod, capital L. Bo, what do you think happens then?
If A is much, much larger than capital L, then A plus L is roughly equal to just A.
Then the electric field caused by the charged rod equals the negative of the Coulomb constant times the charge on the rod, all divided by A squared, all times unit vector I.
Why?
Because in the denominator, when we substitute in just A for A plus capital L, we get A times A or A squared.
Okay, sure, but what does that mean?
That means that if we get far enough away from the uniformly charged rod, it has the same electric field as if the uniformly charged rod were a point charge.
Right. I can see that now. It is the same equation I derived at the beginning for the electric field caused by a point charge. That is pretty cool.
Yeah, that was fun.
Yeah.
Can we find the electric field caused by another continuous charge distribution, Mr. P? Please?
Absolutely. But not this time.
Oh, man.
It's okay with me.
Next time.
Okay, next time.
Thank you very much for learning with me today. I enjoy learning with you.